Welcome to Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. We ask you to join us on the internet. We're located at classictalk.tv. That is Classic Talk is one word, .tv. Today is a great pleasure to welcome an immensely talented young American soprano whose career is blossoming by the day and is in demand in all the major opera houses of the world. Eileen Perez, welcome.
Thank you.
Good to have you here.
Thank you, Bing. It's such a pleasure. I'm so excited to meet you guys. I've been watching your interviews with some of the great artists of our time, so it's a thrill to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. Most recently, you just, you know, got an award.
Yes.
You know, Beverly Sills.
The Beverly Sills Award. Yeah.
And not only that, in the last few years, you've had Beverly Sills, you've had Richard Tucker, you've had
Placido Domingo.
That's quite a row of awards.
Quite a legacy, right. And it feels like more of a responsibility. I think that as thrilling it is to receive such a major award, not only from, you know, from our country, which is like the highest, it's one of the most biggest gifts, because it, you know, it's connected to these great artists, the names, their legacies. Also, the family that those foundations become for us all. You know, the Tucker family has been so supportive, and the George London family, the Puccini family, all these wonderful foundations here in New York. For me, the Beverly Sills Award means having a home at the Metropolitan Opera House, which is one of the highest honors for an American singer as well. And it's kind of also, you know, a little intimidating, because you think, right, it's a big responsibility. And now it's my turn not only to keep singing well and to be very conscientious of the roles that I do portray, but also remembering to give back and to work with young artists, to encourage younger talents. And, you know, every step of the way we have these helping hands for us. And so it feels like, as much as I'm receiving, I also feel it's time to find ways in my schedule to give and to connect to the community.
So. Do you think, is it important to you to have these awards, meaning attend competitions?
Yes. Well, I think, you know, there is the major question that any young artist asks is, how do you become an opera singer? And there is no formula. In fact, the way Europe treats or sort of every country has its own path, and in a way, every artist sort of ventures on their own. Some of the most famous singers today, as you know, because you've learned this, didn't even think about it. Or, you know, someone went into music education. I mean, I think about Christine Gerke, for example, who was, you know, was a band geek just like I was. Or, you know, and here she's our premier soprano for Wagnerian repertoire at the moment.
Brunhilde.
Thank God she, you know, but we, you know, there are different paths to become an artist, and there's no one way. And so definitely, for me, becoming an opera singer was a dream, a big dream. I remember when I was 14 or 15 and hearing my first opera aria CD by Maria Callas. I just heard this voice and this music. I've always heard music and had an emotional response to it. I didn't have to know what language it was in, but when I heard the Italian, which is so close to Spanish, I just got it, and I just, oh, I don't know. I think it was just, you know, my teenage years. All of those emotions were awakening too, and the curiosity of you know, theater, travel, language, drama, for sure the drama. I love drama.
Why
all
why
things
her?
I connected to. Well, she was at the music library, or not the music library, excuse me, where I grew up. I grew up in Elk Grove Village, Illinois, and we had a public library. We had a great music education system. So, you know, in grade school, I was having music class, and I was in orchestra and in band. So after junior high, I had already played the flute for, you know, 4 years and could sight read. And in high school was when you could enter into participate in some of the plays, straight, you know, regular plays. Or what I did, I was on a speech team, and you would we would cut plays and do a 10-minute or 8-minute excerpt, I can't remember, and you would compete. You would do dramatic interpretation of a play where you become all those characters, and then you go statewide and nationwide to compete. And then there was musical theater. But to land a role in the musical, you had to take voice lessons. And this is how I got to Maria Callas, because my teacher was a Heldon tenor, but he, you know, he had his family life, and so he dedicated many years to not only singing with the Chicago Symphony Chorus under Schulte, but teaching. And so he taught very fundamental operatic classical voice pedagogy, I guess. But I didn't think of it that way, you know. I go up to my voice lesson, I'm thinking, all right, I'd love to get a part in the musical. What do I have to do? Teach me how to sing. And so he gave me an aria, O mio babbino caro. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. As soon as I heard it, I just had the feeling. And of course, it's funny because that aria is actually a joke, right? But of course, the melancholy you hear in it, I just went right with it and with the Spanish. And he said, oh, well, huh, you're pronouncing the Italian well. You know what you're saying. Okay. Why don't you go and have a listen? And he gave me Maria Callas, UC Bierling, Luciano Pavarotti, Placido Domingo. You know, he gave me a list of all the singers to look for. And, you know, but as soon as I saw that Callas CD, I still remember, I don't know the label. I can't, oh, it is EMI, of course. But it was where you saw, I think it just said Divina on it. And there were three or four different ones where it's just her face and kind of like, not a Warhol way, but a very artistic portrait where you just see her eyes and her mouth and like, and I just remember taking that home and playing it, and that was it. I heard the strains of duet with La Traviata, and I wonder if it was Di Stefano. I'm not sure which tenor it was singing with her, but I just thought, that's it. I have to know more about this lady and more about this music, and then I was just hungry. And then I love musical theater, so I did musical theater as well, but this was another.
Isn't it amazing that today I've read a couple of reviews of yours, and they have made comparisons between you and Callas. And so, I mean, what goes around comes around.
Wow.
That's quite amazing.
That is amazing.
Sound like you're unaware of that.
Well, I would be completely amazed if that translates. But what I love most of all, I'm very aware of the choices that she's making. And I know it might be even too strong to say, but I really feel this, and this is why I go back to her recordings often. You can hear her face when you hear the phrases that she's singing. You can imagine her expression because of the sound you're getting. And the determination of the emotion behind the words and the spoken quality of the sound. And she just thrills me to bits, because I know that she's doing it emphatically or not at all. And that's a great Greek way of being. I remember learning, you know, what enthusiasm means in theater, and you become possessed by this music. And I think that our job as an artist is to, you know, you get your technique, but the technique is there to serve as the grounding for how you're going to bring the character to life. Because it has to be about the character, or it has to be about the music. Otherwise, it's too much ego and too much other stuff. It's too distracting.
You're afraid that you might get too influenced by her in a certain way?
No, I'm influenced by so many people. Uh-huh. You know, another great, you know, soprano, which I think of as probably, I mean, I'm probably doing her PR now, but I mean, Anna Netrebko has been, in a way, probably a similar influence upon our generation that Maria Callas had on hers. I mean, in a sense, as soon as Anna touches a role, it's like, oh, how can it be better? I mean, she totally throws herself into it. But, you know, it's different. It's Anna, and she's very generous. And I've had the pleasure of understudying her, and I will never forget her kindness and generosity towards me as a young artist. And she was very, she was gracious once to pull me from the chorus and just have me take a bow with her. So that's, I mean, but that's Anna. And you can, I bet everybody has a great story about how she has, you know, just lifted you up to some great encouraging, a hug or a word or a big high five or a dance or a drink or whatever. I mean, Anna, I love that lady a lot, a lot. And, but, you know, I feel spoiled in a way to be in this generation of artists because we have all of the, for example, the vocalization of Rosa Poncel, and we have so many documents and discographies that we can all listen to. So our imagination better be more on point, because imagine how these artists, how they had all the capacity to bring all of these roles to life on their own, with influence possibly, but so now we have to do even more, I think. I think we have to stretch it and, or to know better. Or, well, I observed a lesson with James Levine just yesterday working with the Lindemann Young Artist, and he said, you know, theater has been around for hundreds and hundreds of years. We need your face. We need your face for the sound, for sure. But that's theater. So, sure, be in profile when you're listening to someone. And I just think, thank you. I needed to hear that. Because, you know, we're in the age also of the production being the foremost important thing. But we've got to get back to the singing. We've got to get back to a balance of it all. Because we could all even look pretty. But if we sound amiss.
Could not agree with that
word
more.
It doesn't. Or maybe it does, but boy, we owe the art form, the composers, the audience, we owe them the grandeur of what it could be.
Going back to that musical, did you get the role?
I didn't.
You didn't?
I didn't, but I did. I auditioned for the role of Mabel in Pirates of Penzance, which is the lead role, which is really, you know, gutsy for a young little freshman to try to get the lead role.
Right.
But thankfully, I was able to sing the role of Edith, you know, and so climbing over Rocky Mountains, you know, was a lot of fun. And then the next year, I sang one of the kids in the telephone hour in Bye Bye Birdie. And it was my junior year where I had a lead role in Sarah and Guys and Dolls. Oh, and I loved it. My senior year, I had the time of my life. I sang Reno Sweeney in Anything Goes.
Ah.
And, you know, we danced. We had tap dance number. And that was the top. That was the top.
So you grew up in Philadelphia?
Actually, I grew up in Elkhart Village, Illinois.
Which is
and
okay.
then Where? Which is near O'Hare Airport by Rolling Meadows, Arlington Heights, Schaumburg.
Very close to Chicago.
It's close-ish. But yeah, I mean, I would say I don't know Chicago that well because I'm pretty much a suburban kind of girl. So
So you come from
that's just high school. Oh my gosh, I just spoke about all of that. Okay. High school. I'm trying to decide where I'm going to do next. And, you know, it's time to go pick a college and decide a major and think of all those things, ACT scores, SAT scores. And yeah, I didn't do too well on them. It wasn't bad, but I wasn't like, all right, I'm going to get scholarship for my scores.
Right.
And my aunt had come to a concert, and she just really influenced. You know, she was just in tears. And it is my aunt, but she did say, what you're doing is really special. Just remember that. And I thought, okay. And then my sociology teacher, I remember he asked, oh, what are you looking at, you know, to apply for? And I was like, well, I want to go to Northwestern University. I want to, you know, be a specialized surgeon. And I had hopes like, you know, writing a great essay. You always have to, you know, write an entry essay for the school. And he said, oh, you want to help heal people. And that's when I thought, okay, back to the drawing board. I was thinking of, like, how much a surgeon would make in a year, you know? And then, of course, not even knowing how to sew, that wasn't going to work out. So back to the drawing board, and I realized, wow, I've collected so many credits in high school of participating in band. I was a, you know, drum major. I had led sectionals. I was also in core, in the choir, and show choir, and, you know, and I thought, all right, I have a lot of fine arts credits here. Why not see if I can audition for a music scholarship? And that's when I spoke to my teacher again, Carl, and I said, okay, I don't know about becoming an opera singer, but I really want to go to college. And he said, good idea. And he gave me the top five. And he said, you really want to start out at Indiana University because you know, Giorgi Tozzi's there, Martino Arroyo, Virginia Zaiani, all of these great singers were there. And so I thought, great, I'll apply. Give me the list. I'm putting the applications in. Then I did the auditions, and they accepted me. And I met with Miss Arroyo, and she didn't take any undergraduate students. She was, you know, had a very limited studio. And she met my parents and met me and said, well, you have a very, you know, you're very talented, but this life is very difficult. It requires a lot of sacrifice. And I just want you to know that things may not work out, but you would be welcome to study with me in the studio. You'd be welcome here at IU, and I'll see what I can do and speak to the dean on your behalf to see if there's scholarship money. Mm-hmm. And of course, I think I heard, I get to study with her. Uh-huh. I didn't hear the rest of it. The rest of it, I was like, And you know, I look back and I think, well, she was so right. But what was extraordinary about my time at IU was not that I got to do so much in the opera theater, but I met, because of Ms. Arroyo's relationship, collaborative relationship with Leonard Hokanson, a great pianist and leader pianist, I was able to collaborate with one of his graduate students and attend lead class every Wednesday that would go from 7 to 11, which really ended up being 7 to 12:30 because of all the chit-chat. And so I really fell in love with leader and found a new path in art song. And then by those 4 years, I thought, okay, now how do I get to the next step?
And did you get this from your parents?
The ambition, singing? Yes. The singing, maybe, no.
No.
No, I think I got from my parents was I had to do, and maybe it's something that they didn't really tell me to do, but I always felt like there are three phrases my mother always said, and it's superate, which is better yourself, mm-hmm. Ponle ganas, which is put the oomph in it, you know, put your heart into what you do, mm-hmm. and no te dejes, which is don't let anybody keep you down, mm-hmm. like go and try and always do your best and see where that goes. And so I think that that's what they mostly, and a lot of support. My family would, you know, drive Midwestern, or just my family, we drove everywhere. They would drive 4 hours to Bloomington and mm-hmm. then 4 hours back. And on the first Thanksgiving where I had to study, I said, Mom and Dad, you know, I can't go home. I really have to study. And they said, okay. And the next thing I know, they arrive with tamales. My mom made tamales and she brought it. And, you know, I had made really great friendships there. And so my next step ended up being the Academy of Vocal Arts, which is a tuition-free institution that allows 4 years of performance practice in opera, which was exactly what I needed. And thankfully, I got in. So from there, I would say that's how my other steps happened. So competitions became important. Wow, I'm a looper. Sorry. Yeah, but that's what I would say. Auditioning wasn't my best suit. I don't think I was ready. I mean, I remember a lot of my soprano colleagues, boy, they just had, one could just sing Martha Nallaatin like at 9 a.m. and 10 p.m. and all times, and just was really strong, gorgeous girl. Audition package was always together. Actually, most everybody had their audition arias together. And still to this day, I can't tell you what my favorite 5 arias would be to sing. I'm closer now. I know the top 3. But, but you know, that's a real, it's something that we push young singers to do, and I still think it's important. I just felt like, wow, I couldn't figure it out. I always kept trying to do the most impressive piece. And then I found out, oh, they liked Achichfuls, you know? And I thought, what's happening? Yeah.
What is your first award?
My first award mm-hmm. was arriving in Philadelphia. They had a Mario Lanza competition. Uh-huh. And I sang Reñaban el Silencio, and that was my first prize award in Philadelphia.
How was it?
It was great, but it was then one of a different step. So there was also Giovanna Cavaliere would also present an award in her father's honor, and that was the next award I won. And then, you know, I auditioned for the Belvedere competition, so I applied for a scholarship, and AVA gave me enough money for my airfare and hotel, which was super helpful. And I did well over there, but I was the one American in the finals. and I met a Viennese agent, but, you know, as soon as you meet an agent, they put you to work. But I was still in my first couple years at AVA. So I would say even the summers I worked, and it wasn't until I had an opportunity to go to the Marilla Opera program where I prepared And True Love. And that was, I think, a big award, probably the biggest award, just to get the exposure to San Francisco Opera, the staff there, to sing at the War Memorial Hall in the recitals. And, of course, for the, I think for the Race Progress, we were at Yerba Buena. There's a concert hall there. But what an intensive, artistic, great experience it was for me. To meet other singers, to all be on different shows, to also have, they had, and I think they still do have a program where they invite young coaches, you know, from Manhattan School of Music or all over the country audition, and so they're learning how to coach. And we just, we're great friends. In fact, on Sunday night, I sang Ruzalka's aria with Miloš Žilinski.
Miloš.
And we were back in the day in Marilla together.
Oh, wow. One competition that a lot of singers take this route, I'm curious, did you ever enter the Metropolitan National Council auditions?
Yes, I did. Yes, I did. And I was still thrilled I placed. I mean, uh-huh. I felt like I won. No, but I did it in Washington, D.C. And I think that year, a really famous, a very well-established soprano now as well, also from AVA, Ellie Dean, won first place, and then she went on to the finals. Yeah, but after that, I just thought, I don't know. I think it just, I was commenting to a friend at the Met. I was like, you can tell I never did the Monsi auditions. I just, oh, it's hard for me to come up with a list and then to just go back to back to back to back and to be in a good mood, you know? And maybe it's because I gravitate towards the opera heroines that die, and actually they're languid arias. They're not really showy, except Sempre Libera. But that's not really where the heart is for me. That's where she's saying, you know, the heck with everything, you know? But so, I think I wish I did, but that was...
Every singer has their own way. And
well, the other thing is I was so focused on the roles that I was assigned at AVA. I had 6 roles there over the course of 4 years, which is a lot. And so, you know, the first one was Lucia, and the next one was Susanna in The Marriage of Figaro, Anna in Le Villi by Puccini, Suzel, you know, L'Amico Fritz, Adina, Gilda. It was plenty.
You got to sing the entire roles of all these things.
With orchestra. Mm. With orchestra, yeah. So part of that, too, is I was so focused because I knew one thing, and maybe it's something, again, that goes back to my parents. They told me to stay involved. Like, you can work. You have to work. You know, getting a job is a must, and you will have to work. But if there is time afforded to just study, study, because that will pay off more later. And I still, you know, it's still the truth, isn't it? The more you can, you have to work, but you do have to make time to rest and study to sort of stay ahead of the curve and grow. So
we have a lot more to talk about.
Okay.
Unfortunately, we need to take a break.
I know. So I'm like,
this is Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today, we're having the great pleasure of speaking with Eileen Perez. We'll be right back.